The following program was made possible thanks to the generous support of our Kickstarter backers.
Well, first Holmes was born, then he got fat, bald, and tired.
Sup, Holmes?
Beware! Your host, Jonathan Ho!
Hello, everyone! Can you believe it? The one and only Austin Ivansmith back for some reason on this show. I mean, I know the reason I want him on, because he's great. He's very passionate, knowledgeable, makes a lot of video games. But most people say, oh, yeah, it was great to be on your show once. Some people say, oh, I'll come on again, I guess. Only Austin Ivansmith says, hey, can I come on your show again? I'd like to be on your show, please. I'm like, of course you can be on the show. For three times, this is your third time. This is
my third time. Yep. Yeah, I'm really happy to be here. I'm happy to be here for my third time. So. Thanks for the really nice intro.
Anytime.
That's the only reason I come here. I want to be like flattered and showered with like your happy praise.
Oh, well, that's kind of you to say.
I don't get it at home at all. So the wife gets this mean to me. It's just like I'm a disappointment on a daily basis. So having someone talk nice to me is a nice challenge.
I think last time you were on the show, it was maybe from your, was it from the office or from the house? I remember wolves. I remember feeling of warmth. No wolves. So there's the warmth this time, but I don't know where you are now. There's a cool looking Shantae poster like behind you.
This is literally my cubicle at work. It's funny because I turn the camera on the other way, you'd see a lot of cool art hanging on the wall. This is the back way towards some other people's cubes, and I've got a whiteboard over here with a bunch of doodles, actually Shantae related. And that was just a Pirate's Curse thing Nintendo put together, I think, for like IndieCade. And we had like four or five of them. And we did a poster recently when we went to PAX. So that's only there for making sure like layout is right. And then, there's no one sitting behind me right now. So
Guys, it's a Sunday. Here you are at work on a Sunday. Talk to me.
Exactly. Well, I would have done it. So the first one I did from home. The second one I actually did from my mom's house because we had to travel for her birthday. And then today the kids are gonna maybe nap. And I thought it'd be really funny if I was at home and like my son came in and was like, hey, look, we're talking on a computer. But I thought it might be better to come here and be able to focus. Funny enough, this is my third time on this show. Every time I've been on your show, my wife has been pregnant.
Is that true as of now too?
Yes. Yeah, we have a baby due October 13th. So we're about to have our third kid. It should be fun. And I know you just had a baby.
I did. My wife had our baby. He's out on a walk somewhere right now, though my dog is in the room and I've got a squirt gun. I have to like, threaten to hurt my dog with water, which doesn't hurt that much every time I do this show.
No, that's good.
Professionalism. So, wow, third kid on the way. How do you do it? Not an easy question to answer, I'm sure, but you make a lot of video games, you work on Sundays, and you have your third kid on the way. How do you juggle it all?
I mean, I have a really good partnership with my wife. You know, she's really, we're really understanding of each other and each other's like time. And, you know, if one of us is having a hard day, we know to like kind of, you know, support the other person, or she's really supportive of me. Like I traveled to, you know, different cities and countries, to promote games, and I'm like, hey, I got to go to Seattle for a few days. She's like, okay, cool, have fun. I'll go stay at my parents, and you know, we make it work. So she's really cool about that. So I think, you know, it'd be a lot different if we didn't have a really good sort of like working relationship on you know, understanding time like that. And then just with the kids, I don't think we would have gone for three kids if the first two weren't like reasonable and decent kids. They're not extreme terrors, but like, they have their moments. It's like my son, he's 3 years old. He got mad at my wife and he like threw a sock at her. It's like, and you try so hard not to laugh. It's like, oh my God, that's so funny. It's just like, I'm so angry to throw a sock at you. And you know, like you have moments like that. Luckily, a lot of it's funny. So, but I think also segmenting time, you know, is a big thing where it's like you have time for work, come home every day at the same time, spend time with the kids. My wife is usually tired by like 9 or 10 p.m. So after 9 or 10, my time's my own until I go to bed around like midnight to 2, somewhere in that range. So that's where I make a game, play a game, you know, during weekends, I usually develop games at Starbucks between like 1 p.m. and 3 p.m. during nap time. And then, you know, after 10 p.m. at night then. So any game I'm making is usually in those times. I don't work on things when my kids are awake. You know, I spend time with my family on the weekends. So,
my God, it's similar to your way forward colleague, Adam Tierney, who has kids as well. And I'm just like, how are you making all this stuff? And I'm still puzzled. Adam's working on like a billion projects. You putting out games with Way Forward, and also put out some games of your own on the phones and places. There is, of course, Flappy Bard. Who could forget Flappy Bard?
Flippy Bard.
Flippy Bard.
He flips.
I did forget Flippy
Bard. No, it's the world's best pun. It's a Flappy Bird. It's Flippy Bard. And I wasn't the only person to think of that. I think the Sunday night, Dong Nguyen said he was going to take Flappy Bird off the store. Like a dozen people at the exact same time had the same idea, as it turns out.
Flippy Bard idea?
Flippy Bard, yeah. If you go on Twitter and you saw like the night he announced it, I know Gama Sutra writer even said it, and I saw that like the next day. But I told my wife, you know, she was going to bed and we were just talking about it. It was like 8 p.m. or something like that. And I'm like, it's so stupid. There's gonna be so many clones. They're all gonna be Flappy something. There's not gonna be anything funny. There's not gonna be any good puns like, or no one's gonna change the name like Flippy Bard. I'm like, oh my God. And it just like hit me like right then. Like, that's so good. I gotta make it. And she's like, no, don't do that. I was still working on my garbage truck game I was making for my son. And she said, don't do it. And I was just like, I can get this done in like a day. She's like, no, you can't. I'm like, you watch me. Like, I took it as a challenge. Like, you know, I will get this done. And so I did. And it was funny. But the rest is history. Made like $3 off of it.
It was fun.
It was fun to do. So,
and as people who haven't played it won't know, and what is wrong with you, go out and play the Flippy Bard as opposed to a Flippy Bard, the real Flippy Bard. It's kind of like that Ghostbusters cartoon situation.
Well, that was just funny because, yeah, there was this other guy who like put it out, and he put it out like an hour or a day before I did on like the Android store, and the Android store doesn't have any kind of priority on naming rights. So whereas with iOS, like I made it that night and I put it on the Apple store. So I had it on the Apple store and I did the Android store at the same time. I just didn't release it for a few days. So then like, I guess my wife was playing the game and she didn't like his version. She gave it like a star on the pad. And then the person like reached out to me and it's like, hey, you know, thanks for giving me a bad review, even though I made my game first. I was like, what? I didn't even know what happened. I was like sidelined by it. I'm like, she's like, oh, that was probably me. The guy was cool. I messaged him like, hey, sorry about that. It was just a misunderstanding. Like I actually downloaded it just to see what the other Flippy Bard was like.
And it's different than your Flippy Bard.
It is. And mine's different than Flappy Bird. I had actually played Flappy Bird before I made it. And I just did it for fun. And I even put multiplayer in because I wanted to, you know, do something that wasn't just, you know, just a complete clone. I did my own thing. There's multiple characters, and it just was fun. It was fun to work on it, and then just became this evolution of experimentation and going from there. And I was just like, you know, knee deep in Game Maker at the time, just having a lot of fun, you know, trying to make new things and making things in Game Maker in my spare time. And then that's all what kind of led into Academy, where, you know, in December, rather, I was done with a couple projects and I needed something new to do in my spare time in Game Maker. And I thought, well, you know, I'd like to do a platformer rather than trying to make my own thing. It might be interesting to appropriate the Mighty Switch Force graphics and make a Switch Force game in Game Maker, just to prototype the engine, just to kind of get a feel for it. And then, I made just one of the levels for Mighty Switch Force, and I showed it to Matt Bozon and just, you know, wanted to do it as a prototype. And he said, well, let's make a whole game out of it. And then the rest is, you know, kind of history.
History in development. History. Yeah. Mighty Switch Force Academy is out on Steam Early Access now. It's still Early Access, right?
Yeah. There's 24 people watching right now. I'm going to put a download code in there right now. So, there's a download code in the chat. Oh, what? That's what I do. Every show, I got to bring the codes.
That's incredible. People happy out.
That's for Steam. That's for Steam, whoever's in there. But
is it only on Steam now?
Or at the moment. See, this is the thing is it isn't Early Access. Like the thing I like to make sure people understand is you know, looking like Shantae, for example, it was our Kickstarter. It needed to be kickstarted. We didn't have the funds to actually make it, and so you know, we put it on Kickstarter, and the money that we earned through Kickstarter went towards development. There's a lot of games that, you know, it seems like they ask for Kickstarter funds and the game's somehow out like 1 month later, and it's like, well, you know, was it done already? You know, our game, it's like the funds are actually being applied to, you know, all the steps of development. And with Academy and Early Access, it's the same thing where, you know, I would be at the same point I am now in development, it would come out when it's going to come out, no matter what, but you're seeing it sooner. So you're actually seeing like a very, very, very pre-alpha. It's just that people are playing it. And we decided to do Early Access because it's in a new engine. It's in Game Maker now. And we wanted to get kind of the kinks worked out since we're basically rewriting the Switch Force physics, you know, engine. there's a lot of speedrunners out there, and there's a lot of people who are just really familiar with the game who are finding very, very, very intricate bugs. Well, some of them are obvious, but some of our testers haven't found them, so it's really good that they've been finding them. Yeah, they're pretty game breaking, and they're kind of funny, but they're like also disheartening. Cause it's like, oh, how could you be so stupid, Austin, and you know, not see that you can, I don't know, intersect the floor while shooting your mighty shot, you know, at a certain speed while switching, and it's like, oh, and so yeah, having to hunt down that code and fix it is very fun.
I want to start for the closer to the top, not the very top, but closer to the top for people who may not know. Mighty Switch Force is one of WayForward. WayForward Studios has been around forever. Matt Bozon was on the show a while back. He's a co-founder of the studio. He was making like Kermit games on like graph paper somehow and sending them to Jim Henson and being like these graphics? And he was like, yes, A plus, like forever ago in the 80s. WayForward been around for so long, but one of WayForward's most popular, most prolific intellectual properties is the Mighty Switch Force property. Probably most people know Shantae. Shantae's been in three games total with you know, enhanced ports here and there. Mighty Switch Force, same amount now with Academy in Early Access. There was Mighty Switch Force 2. It's a puzzle platformer with comedy, cuteness, and cleverness is how I would probably describe it. You're a cop with a alarm, a siren on her head, and she's got a gun. Sometimes she's got a hose. I don't know if you've integrated the hose mechanics into Academy yet, because Academy takes it back to when Patricia Wagon, the star of Mighty Switch Force, was in school.
Basically, that's sort of the premise, is that she's going into a virtual reality training camp, but she's also a cyborg, so is it all in her imagination, or is it something she's actually doing? We may never know, or we might, or none of the above. Yeah, actually, this is, I think, technically like the fifth Switch Force game, because
if you count the HD Switch Force, yeah, which you worked on.
Yep, call it HD, which was kind of its own thing. It's its own beast. And then there was a Hose It Down, which was like a spinoff.
Oh, I'm sorry. I forgot about Hose It Down.
How dare you forget about Hose It Down? No, it's okay. Yeah, that was something Montana did. It was it's kind of a side project puzzle game, which it's neat. It's a fun little game based off like the hose mechanic for the the tube blocks, or I forget what they were called in Switch Force 2. But yeah, you know, and it's funny because the premise for Mighty Switch Force Academy is started back in 2011 when we were actually going to port Mighty Switch Force to the Wii. This was before Wii U was even an idea in our heads. So Switch Force came out on 3DS in like, maybe it was 2012. It came out in like 2011. It came December 2011. Okay, so like spring of 2012, we tried porting Switch Force to the Wii. And when the programmer first put it in, they didn't change any of the camera properties. So all the pixels drew 1:1 on a 720p screen. So, you know, the 3DS is like 400 by 240. And they were very small on the screen, but you could see so much more. And Matt Bozon was like, oh my gosh, this is great. Like, this should be, you know, a Switch Force game at some point. And then in Switch Force 2, the actual level 15, the art for that was going to be the precursor for okay, the next Switch Wars game is going to be Academy. It's going to use this tile set. It's going to have this, you know, kind of grid futuristic, like hollow grid thing going on. And so that was sort of the idea for a long time. It's just, it didn't get to start happening until I had the bandwidth to just kind of make it happen. Hmm. So
and, on Game Maker, which is so you had the Switch Force engine tweaking it along the way. There's definitely changes. It at least feels to me that there's changes in between Switch Force releases. But you started brand new with Game Maker. Game Maker has a reputation for being quite easy to use, but not if you try to do difficult things with it, like let's say a physics-based puzzle game with shooting and blocks moving in and out of the foreground and background and multiple planes and all the stuff you're twisting Game Maker. And even though you had an engine already, I was very interested to hear why you moved ahead in that direction.
Well, the engine, the programmer who works with that engine, you know, he has not as much bandwidth to do some of these things. And it was more of an experiment. It was like the plan was for doing the game in his engine at some point. He wasn't available to do it because he is bogged down with other projects. There weren't any other programmers internally that had the time to do this project either. So it wasn't that, you know, it couldn't do it, or it was more just a matter of time. It was just that I had the availability, I had the experience in Game Maker, and it was just going to be a prototype. It was just, let's prototype what it's going to be, so when it comes time to make it, we have some things already made, and then it'll be in there. But yeah, who knows? Like, it could even be like that in the end. We could potentially abandon Game Maker if there's like some major bugs that I can never resolve, or there's some, you know, speed limitations that I can never resolve. We might switch back to the other program. And, you know, the fact that it's almost already made, it would go pretty quickly. But I don't think that's going to happen. This is just, we like to do experiments. We like to try things. You know, let's try making an Apple Watch game. Let's try doing a 3DS game. You know, let's just see, let's throw spaghetti at the wall, see what sticks. And this was, well, maybe Game Maker's an opportunity to make smaller games. Granted, you know, Switch Force is a little bit bigger. There's a lot of complex pieces. But this is an experiment in, well, all of our programmers are bogged down in other things. I'm assigned to Shantae. I have a little bit of bandwidth in Shantae because, you know, I probably have like a Google Friday type thing where, you know, you work 4 days and then you have a Friday to just do other things. So it's kind of like spending 10 or 8 hours a week, 1/5 of your week, just on something to help, you know, outside of the project. And so that's what I was doing. I was just experimenting with, you know, getting Switch Force made in something else, and then we're just moving forward with it. And, you know, I actually got the game up and running in like, I guess I logged my hours. It was just 40 hours that I had all of the components for running, jumping, switching, most of the blocks, most of the enemies, and that was it. You know, the rest of it's come down to making menus, making the art for the levels, designing the levels, getting multiplayer working. Multiplayer has been, you know, one of the bigger hurdles. So that's where a lot of the time has gone into that. So
again, I would laugh because you, sir, you are a director of video games.
Right.
You have assembled the former voice cast of DuckTales and been like, talk like this, DuckTales actors. That'll be good. You've done some things that are
clarify. I didn't assemble them. Disney assembled them, and it was Disney's idea. And I just sat back and went, yeah, that's cool. And I actually didn't do a lot of voice directing. It was mostly like they had the main guy, like, who, you know, he had a voice director, the person who does that for his job on a daily basis, who was doing most of the thing. And he'd turn to me and go, did that work for you? And I'd be like, yes. And 80% of the time it was yes. The other 19% was maybe just one more take. And only 1% of the time was, no, I don't like it, make him do this. So it was rarely wrong. So when you're working with people that are like that professional, it just goes pretty darn smooth. So, but thank you. Sorry. I'm going to untoot my horn there. I just wanted to make sure that we got that clarified.
I don't claim to be an expert, a full expert, even though I feel like I'm a full expert on all things Austin Ivansmith. I'm sure that you know your life a little better. So I appreciate the correction. But all kind the same, you've been directing stuff on a pretty high level, is my long-winded point. And now here you are being like, well, I'll just do every aspect to, I'll like make a game. You're not necessarily a programmer by trade. WayForward as programmers, you could have sat on your throne at WayForward and been like, when a programmer is ready, they can take my work and put it into the game. But instead you were like, nah, I'll take my off day from my video game making job and make another video game that might like work out. And then, you know, tonight at midnight, between midnight and 2 a.m., I may be found making a video game, even though my job is making video games. You're making a lot of video games. You're doing a lot of the work that people in your position may not want to do. They may just be off goofing off, but not you, sir. You're making the things.
Yes.
I'm right about that.
Thank you.
Okay, I got that part right. All right, I was waiting for the correction.
No, there's no correction. I will never correct you ever again, sir. I have found that I enjoy making games. It's kind of become my art. It's become the hobby that I like doing. There's something just very, very rewarding about popping open something like Game Maker. And I like Game Maker because it's you don't have to set up a lot of the technical stuff. It's like all set up for you. I like to use the analogy that, like, I mean, I can program a little bit. You know, I've done a little bit of C and you know, I understand some decent, like, logic, you know, or order of events and whatnot that make it pretty easy. But I don't know how to set up things from a technical level. I tried doing hacks, Flixel, and all that stuff, and there's so many technical hurdles to set those things up that it was very difficult. With Game Maker, you know, it's like a programmer set it up for me. It's kind of like I have a programmer who said, oh, I've got the project ready for you. And that's kind of how it is on these projects, you know, like a bigger one like Shantae and other ones where you sit down with someone and you have a programmer like, okay, well, here's install Visual Studio. Just hit this button, you know, go to this folder and hit this button. It's like, I hit the button. It didn't work. We're going to go hit this other button, then hit this button. It's like, oh, okay, it works now. Thanks. You know, so that's what making a game is, where you have the programmer that knows what they're doing, who sets up everything. You know, they're like the mechanic of you know, like I turn the key in the car. No starting car, and it's like, yeah, you know, there's no gas in the engine, blah, 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 you know, gas in the tank.
But with this project,
you drive car good. But, you know, it's just kind of how it is. That's why I like Game Maker. And again, you know, it's just an experiment. Like, we want to be doing more original titles. We want to be doing more, you know, small bets, things like Switch Force, things like Milky Way and Flip Champs, where they're just, you know, fun little games like Watch Quest. And this is just an opportunity. Like, I had bandwidth and no one else did. Everyone else is very slammed with things. And, you know, it would have been a distraction and pulled people away from other projects. And so it's like, well, let's just look at this as an opportunity to try something. And, you know, we'll never shy away from, you know, taking the opportunity to just make a game or try something. So, you know, the next time we want to do something like this, if there's a programmer available, we'll evaluate which engine we do it in and what makes the most sense. Or if we make a programmer available. You know, so that's just, it's, you know, it's a business. There's lots of hurdles, financial hurdles and scheduling and whatnot you have to jump through. And this was just kind of a weird one, but we'll, you know, see how it works out.
It's happening. Yes.
Yeah, me too.
And it could, from the sounds of it, and I don't want to put words in your mouth, and all we can do is speculate, but it's starting on Steam, but it could end up other places. You've already got the Switch Force engine running and other things. So it could be, like you said before, kind of a switch in engines for other ports. Or I don't know, maybe Game Maker can work on other systems. Maybe it can. I have no idea.
It does. Yeah, Game Maker works on PS4, works on Xbox One. I actually got the game running on a PS4 the other day. You know, like, we're not making any promises about which platforms it's going to come out to, but we don't know yet. But we'd like to put it out to, you know, major consoles. You know, that's our goal. You know, so we'll see. But I guess awesome. The other thing, because, like, you know, like, don't want to make promises we can't keep.
Oh,
but but I did get the game running on the PS4 and it ran really well. You know, there's a couple, you know, technical things like save, how file saves are handled, how controllers are handled. And, you know, that's the other reason why we wanted to do it early access, was when there's major game breaking bugs to find, fixing them on Steam first, you know, is a lot easier than only finding them after, you know, four different versions are done and you have to fix it on all four versions and submit to all four places, and then they don't update for days or weeks. So kind of getting the gameplay kinks worked out on early access will be very useful.
That makes a lot of sense.
And if it happens to do really well, if it happens to sell really well, I mean, that'll only be more support we put back into it. It's like, oh man, you know, there was 30,000 people that, you know, bought it in the month of October. Like, I guess we should, maybe let's put in more levels. Hey, maybe let's, you know, put it to these other platforms. So it's funny because it's like, yeah, it's how games are in general. It's like the success of a game determines how much support the next sequel gets or the next, you know, iterations of it get. So it's always funny when I see like, wow, Call of Duty sold really well. Like, you know, like the new Call of Duty sold better than the last one. It's like, well, you know, it's usually people don't pay that much attention to like review scores on like release day. It's like how well the one before it did, or how the last one might not have done as well on release day, but it might have sold a lot over the course of time, over the next like 3 months, out of like word of mouth and like people, you know, saying you should check this out, and then just like builds the number of people it built to are the people that are really interested in the next one, and they go out by day one. Mm-hmm. And then they're like, oh, this was garbage, we shouldn't have bought this, this is bad. And then when they say the next one comes out, it didn't do as well as the last one. It's like, yeah, well, you know, but it sold really well on day one. Well, it sold well on day one based on the previous title. Mm-hmm. Yeah, anyway, just a theory I have.
No, it's a wonderful theory. And it begs the question how you get people in the door, which is from what I've gathered about the face of a game, that's like half the battle. Is like, how do I get you to at least try my game so you can find out if it's any good? Because right. If you don't even try it, it doesn't matter how great it is, because you'll never play it and you'll just say, eh, it didn't look good enough, so I don't even try it. And Switch Force, as I've seen anyway, has done a very good job in getting people to at least give it a try. The first one on the 3DS, from what I understand, sold pretty darn good. Then it moved to the Wii U with the HD version that you were in charge of. And my understanding was that did pretty good too. And then that begged the sequel. I mean, it's gotten people to give it a shot. But with Academy, it seems like you're going after, and this is just how it looks to me, going to Steam first and going with early access. It seemed as though you may be going after an audience who's never tried it before. And I wonder if that's been a challenge.
That actually is what we were trying to do. You know, funny enough, when we released Switch Force originally, the plan was to port it to as many things as possible, as quickly as possible. And we, you know, didn't port it to as many things as possible very quickly, sadly. So we were disappointed in that. But we have been trying to rectify that with the port of HD onto Steam. We're going to be getting... a lot of the Shantae games have been ported to other consoles as well. They've been coming to PS4 and Xbox One, I believe. And, you know, we just announced that Pirate's Curse is coming to Japan on 3DS, which is really awesome. So we're finally getting some overseas attention. Integro, who is publishing that, also published Mighty Switch Force on the eShop in Japan. I think Switch Force and Switch Force 2. So... that's been pretty great. But, you know, we've been wanting to hit platforms outside of Nintendo. We love Nintendo. We love the platforms. But, you know, sadly, there's just not a lot of people that have Nintendo consoles. And if they do, some of them only play first-party games on Nintendo. And it's kind of a bummer. Like, we have a really strong following on Wii U and 3DS, and we love our fans. And so we always want to put a game out on Nintendo. And there's something about putting a game on a Nintendo platform that just feels so just, I don't know, so real, you know. Mm-hmm. It's like when you grow up with Nintendo and you put a game out on a Nintendo console, you feel like you did something great, you know, because it's like a part of your childhood. It's like you're getting to do something that meant so much to you in your childhood. So I don't know, that's but we definitely want to expand our audience. You know, we want other people to know about it. And you know, we're hoping to do that with Academy and all projects going forward. And that's especially what we want to do with Half Genie Hero. You know, like right off the bat, it's going to be on, you know, all the major consoles. It's going to be on PS4, Xbox One, and Wii U, and PC. you know, same day. So that's our you know, our first release day is going to be on all those consoles, because, you know, some of the fans, they don't own multiples, or people that own multiples have their preferred console to play something on. So
good grief. And the
grief is right.
The Kickstarter did very well, if I remember correctly.
It did really well, yeah.
Was it into a million, or was it in the upper
800,000? It finished under a million. But it was, I think, after all totals were tallied with PayPal, it might have been close. So yeah, but it did really, really well.
Which is, yeah, a lot of money. But in game development world, with the kind of team, it's not as though this was like a team of three folks just working out of their basements. We'll get it done, guys. You've got Mariel Cartwright, who worked, she works at Lab Zero. She does the animation direction for Skullgirls. Personally, one of my favorite animators, like, period, end of sentence, out there. She did some work on your game. You've got a huge team of artists. You're putting it on all these consoles same day. Like, I have to imagine that $1 million or so, it wasn't enough to get you through it, or did you have to dig in somewhere else?
Well, I don't know. I don't get to see the finances. I'm not privy to that. I don't know how much people are getting paid. That's a secret. That's for the executive producer to handle. I do know, you know, we originally asked for 400, and for the scope that the project was, it was going to be lean. And we were probably going to go over, but we knew that we could at least get most of the way there with that budget. And, you know, we expanded our stretch goals, and we expanded, I guess specifically the stretch goals, you know, based on how much, more money we would get. And so, you know, it has cost that so far, or will cost that. I don't think we're insanely far off. I don't know. We talked about it a few times, but by the end of the project, it might cost more than what we got, but I can't say for certain. But it definitely wasn't like, you know, oh, we only needed 70K, and there was three of us, and we did the same amount of content in the same amount of time, and we just happened to get like 10 times more money than we originally asked for. I don't think that happens too often. I think there are a lot of the teams, when they do that, they really do expand. I think Banner Saga really did that. The team down at Stoic, where, you know, they had a small budget first, and then when they got like a lot more money, it's like, okay, cool. Now let's get this really great musician, Austin Wintery, to orchestrate the game. And, you know, it's just like they really just build and build and build and build. We try to do the same thing, where it's like, well, let's get more content, more characters. And it's going to be kind of nuts, because there's like multiple playable characters. You've got, you know, Shantae, we've got Risky Boots, which you can play as. And then there's like three alternate characters of Sky, Bolo, and Roddy. And they all have unique styles of play. And then there's three alternate costumes for Shantae. And they all have unique styles of play. So it's kind of like having, I don't know, something like eight or nine like playable characters in the game, and it's pretty crazy, and they all play really, really fun and really different from each other. So I don't know, it's a different kind of Shantae game. So I hope people really like it.
Yeah, I'm absolutely certain they will. Based on just Shantae's ever growing fan base, and people are asking me to ask you if there's any chance of Shantae amiibo, Shovel Knight. Is going to have an amiibo Shovel Knight similar to Shantae, except not quite on the same scope. Shantae has, as you put it, different costumes that play differently and different characters. Shovel Knight has some additional characters, one of which just came out recently. It does totally change the way the game plays, but you guys have to do even friggin' more than that. So on top of that, are you going to try to make an amiibo somehow, like all the fans want?
I wouldn't rule that out. So, you know, it's one of those things you can't really talk about. So, because if we are, then you don't want to say that, oh yeah, we are. Then you, like, you know, release something. And then if you aren't, then it's like, well, we aren't. But then the fans are like, why aren't you? And it's like, you know, there's no right answer. There's no right answer. Other than I can't talk about it, you know, because I think we want to. So, you know, we'll see. That's
in general, this is a suggestion not so much for you, but for Matt and Voldy, the bosses of WayForward. I feel like WayForward could be making even more people happy and making more money for WayForward to put into your games with more merchandise. Maybe there's merchandise I'm just like not seeing, but like in talking with Matt a while back, my feeling at that point was he may not know just how much people want to buy just a thing with Shantae on it. Like right. they just want to badly.
Yeah, he knows now.
So yeah. do you see that potentially happening? Like Mighty Switch Force Academy alone, I could, like, if I were back in high school, I would badly want a Mighty Switch Force Academy Trapper Keeper with like the laser grid behind it. And, you know, the smiling.
Oh my
girl.
God, that's wouldn't such that a good idea. No, yeah. That would be amazing. I want a Trapper Keeper now too. No, you know, I mean, we have some stuff in the works. We're going to be doing some merchandise. You know, the details are being coordinated right now. But you know, there's going to be merchandise happening pretty soon. So, I would just, if you're a fan of WayForward and there's particular merchandise you want to see, I would just engage with us on social media, either on Twitter or Facebook, and just say like, hey, it'd be really neat to have, you know, I'd love to have this, or I'd love to have this. I know when we were doing some Twitch streaming recently, there's, some banners, I think, you know, like that, hanging behind, me and Emily while we were playing the game. They're like that, you know, big banner behind you, so cool. I want a poster of that. It's like, okay, so I don't think we would have thought of posters before. So now posters is something to add to the list of potential merchandise to do. So yeah, Matt knows. He's actually coordinating some stuff right now. So, you know, we'll see. Just hopefully people will be able to buy some WayForward merchandise here in the next number of time frame. broad time frame of not keeping promises. But, sure. Yeah, you know, of course. Yeah, it was really neat. Last year we had, we made a, Voldy wanted to give all the employees WayForward hoodies, and we coordinated with Fangamer. I called them up and they actually made us hoodies that had a WayForward logo going across them. Everyone had a zip hoodie, and it's kind of funny. We've got this long logo, and it's like we put a zipper up the middle. It's like, oh, that's probably really stupid. It's probably going to look awful. But it actually worked great, and it went across the seam really nice, and they made us a little zipper pull. Is that a WayForward logo? No, zipper full. So it was really awesome. So, you know, and then in talking to them, investigating other places, there's a lot of really cool merchandise outlets that are, you know, are making great stuff and are really great to work with. And it's not like, you know, 5 years ago, we're talking about merchandise and it's like, we'd have to manufacture it ourselves and, you know, sell it ourselves. And, but now there's places where, you know, they handle most of the legwork. So there's lots of options out there. So.
Awesome. Yeah, we'll very exciting. Very happy to hear it. And I didn't mean to sound disparaging to poor old Matt Bozon, but it was more his humility.
Like he didn't seem to
get not at all. Just to clarify though, it was more that he didn't seem to understand how much people like really loved the characters he helped create.
There is a humility there because you know, his desk is covered in like Samus toys and other, you know, Japanese action figures. And, you know, he has a, you know, Mega Man Legends 3 thing on his wall or something like that. So, I mean, he's got lots of merch and lots of cool stuff, lots of cool shirts. And when you have your own thing, it's kind of like, it's like, wait, you like my stuff? You like our stuff? Like you really want that? It's like artists deal with that all the time when they like draw something. It's like, what, you think that's good? Or like when some like really talented artist looks at it, it's like, wow, your art is great. And you're like, what, me? No. You know, so I think it was that same kind of thing. It's funny too, you know, with like questions about amiibos and merchandise. It's like, and we get this on like Twitter all the time, like people asking us like, oh, so when are you gonna do this? And it's always funny, like, you know, if they're asking you something that you are doing, that like you can't go like, you know, like when my wife was pregnant and we didn't want to tell anybody yet, and I was hanging out with friends, so like, oh, so you guys gonna have another baby? And it's just like, I can't, you know, you were like, I wanted to tell you right now, but I can't tell you. And then there's other times where it's like, you know, people ask us about, you know, third party games, like, hey, are you gonna go make this game? And it's like, you don't want to say no, we're not gonna do it, because you might be pursuing that place where it's like, hey, let's call up this publisher and be like, we really want to make this game and like try to get it working. And then people start like hounding you about it. When are you going to do this? When are you going to do this? Actually, I think it's more like when your birthday's coming up or Christmas and like you've already bought someone a gift and they're just like trying to hint drop, or like, you know, I don't know when you got engaged. And I'm sure lots of, you know, people have gone through this when they maybe bought an engagement ring, they've got like an engagement plan. And it's like, so when are we going to get married? When are we going to get married? When are we going to get married? And it's like, I bought an engagement ring. I'm proposing in 2 weeks. Why can't you wait? So I don't know. We'll see. But then also, it might be the opposite where you're not going to do it. It's like, when are we going to get married? It's like, I'm never marrying you. I don't know. So,
and you know that, but you can't say it.
Yeah, you gotta I can't say I'm not gonna marry you. Yeah, so I need you to like me. Yeah, that's a good analogy for fans and not working on games. God, I'm gonna get fired after today.
Oh no, you're not. The fans are gonna eat that up. Meeting them where they're at, because you know what it's like to be a fan. You know what absolutely. It's like to want, you know, so and so to make such and such game, and they can't say it. Yep. So you know how they feel. Speaking of which, you did DuckTales. I wanted to talk more about how it felt post DuckTales. DuckTales hit retail, which is really cool. I don't know if it hit retail when we were talking last time. I can't remember if that was already announced.
Yeah, I don't know if it was announced because it was. I think it was still secret at the time. It's really funny because I was working on DuckTales when I did the first Sub Holmes. And I really wanted to say it, but I guess the announcement was going to happen at PAX East. It was a pretty awesome announcement. Mm. And then, you know, the reaction was so positive at PAX East that, and there was, I guess, a number of pre-sales that they decided to go retail with it. And that was phenomenal. Just having like a boxed copy of that game was just, you know, so amazing. So yeah, I don't know if I don't remember if we knew at the time.
Yeah,
I could say something. It was actually really funny because we were working on getting the okay. So I had my kids are kind of like bookends for DuckTales. My first two kids, at least, where my son was born, and then when I got back from like my paternity leave, I started working on DuckTales, and then I left right as we submitted the disc version of DuckTales, and then my daughter was born like the next few days. So it's kind of like the bookends of my children. And then we did the iOS port, that didn't intertwine at all with my third kid in any way. So much for that. That child will forever be a disappointment to me for not lining up.
But that's where Academy comes in. Academy sounds like it's going to be being put out fully into the world when the child who your wife is pregnant with now is fully put out in the world. There may be something around there. Maybe.
I mean, we've still got weeks or months of work to do on Academy. There's lots of fine tuning. So, yeah, and the baby's due in like 2 weeks. So.
Oh, wow. You're kidding. No. That's amazing. All right. So not quite perfectly lining up, but in the ballpark.
That's why if I was going to come on Sub Holmes again, now would be a good time because there won't be a third baby to have to deal with. So, and it's like an Academy just came out. So it's like, hey, let's go get people to buy Academy, you know? And before my baby comes, and it's like, sorry, honey, like, I've got this internet show to go do. You watch the three kids. Like, no.
Yeah, makes perfect sense. So you got it in while you still could. And for people who don't know, what are the major differences between Academy and prior Switch Force games?
So Academy, and for people that don't know, let's do another code, and it's going to show up there. Actually, I'm going to wait. I'm going to wait till I see my hands do this, and then I'll make the code go. Haha, and then you'll have to hurry. So Switch Force Academy is single screen. The game runs at 1080p, it kind of plays a lot like the first one. So there's not the hose. The fire hose is the second one. She was a firefighter. I mean, that's sort of the big thing is that it's on a single screen and it screen wraps. And it wasn't going to screen wrap at first, but like it just felt really lame. Oh, there go my hands. I'm going to send this code out. There you go, everybody. All right. So there's a little bit of delay. So when you... when I was playing the game, and I was like down in the one corner, and you go to the other corner, or to get back up, it's like, oh, it's so slow. It's like, oh, what if I screen wrapped? It just seemed natural. So that's sort of, I think, like the big hook. And everyone's first reaction is, oh, the camera's so far away. If I'm playing single player, can't just zoom in? And it's like, yeah, maybe, but that's kind of not what the spirit of this game is. So I kind of want to be like, no, not gonna try it. But yeah, that's that at its heart is what Academy is.
And what do you think that does differently? A hint for me is that it for me the difference is it makes the game feel more about game design. Like when I see the big picture at once, I'm thinking about the game like how a designer would have to think about, not just screen by screen, but a designer has to think how is this whole thing going to fit together as one cohesive whole, even though the player only experiences it a screen at a time, to look at the big picture the way you do in Academy makes me feel like I have to kind of deconstruct the big picture as a whole and work backwards from whatever designs you have to do, as opposed to another game, which the first games, I mean, which kind of feel more like just I'm following a character forward and who knows what'll happen. It's just a sweet cartoony time, which, you know, Academy is too, but Academy feels more cerebral, I guess, overall. At least.
Yeah, you got it. I don't have to say anything. You just nailed it. Please, keep going.
That's my problem.
I'm gonna get my coffee. No. Actually, no, it's fine because, you know, it's a Sunday. I'm tired. The caffeine mostly kicked in, but it's sometimes it's hard for me to articulate why something is as important or interesting when it's just like, I can just sit down. I just want to do it. Just let me do it. You know, like, I don't want to talk about it. Just let me do it. And a lot of it is kind of emergent in the development of, you know, you start up with one thing like, okay, well, we know the concept of let's go single screen. And then like, okay, let's go from there. And then we got the screen wrapping to happen. And then I thought about it. It's like, you know, with this whole single screen, you know, it'd be great if like multiple people could go at the same time, especially for, you know, a couple of level designs are very symmetrical. So I just thought, oh, it'd be great if maybe there was like two players could go at the same time. Well, what if there's four players? You know, it just sort of becomes like, you know, the negative term is usually feature creep in a game in development. So if you're a programmer and the person in charge keeps coming up with ideas, you say feature creep because you're very frustrated and they keep throwing ideas at you and you have to change the way things are implemented to fit those new ideas in. But if you're a creator, you don't say feature creep. You know, that's like, it's like a, you know.
Pejorative.
Yeah. It's like, how dare you say feature creep? This is a great idea. But I've been on both sides of that. So I get to say that. It is what it is right now based on a series of steps that got us there. And it is different. What was interesting to me is that, so the original Switch Force had a few different level design layouts. There were the very long horizontal stretches. They're very action-based. There was the sort of snake levels where there was a starting point and you got pathed through, you know, a level that wasn't horizontal. You might go left and right, up and down. And then there was the ones that were, you started more in the middle and they were open both ways. And that's the classic stages that appear in the game. So it's stage 2, 4, 7, 11, and 14 from the original Mighty Switch Force. And they had that sort of layout to them. And that's what this is. You know, they kind of just drop in right away, because when I was designing those particular levels, you had to think about it as a whole. Like, you know, you kind of try to visualize what a player path might be and how that would affect something on the other side. So if they went through this path over in this area and they didn't switch again, what would they come across if they then showed up over here? You know, so it's a very similar thing. And now it is very cerebral. Thank you for that compliment. Because I wouldn't have used that word if you hadn't said it, but it was perfect. How poignant. Apropos that, you know, what happens in multiplayer? So what happens when I'm doing this? What are you going to be doing over here? In fact, there's actually another multiplayer block that I'm going to, I was putting in, and I don't know if it's going to be the default multiplayer or if it's going to be an alternate type of multiplayer where blocks that only a particular player can switch. So there's player one blocks, player two blocks. So if player two switches, the player one blocks don't switch at all. So you might have a path where player two and player one are like, oh, I'll go up my blocks because I control them. And then you get to a corridor where it's like, well, shoot, now I have to switch the blocks for the other person. So it becomes a game of communication, becomes a big thing on teamwork and working together and communication is a big thing. When I played the game with some people here and you aren't paying attention to what they're doing and they're not paying attention to you and you're not talking, you end up crushing each other. And sometimes it's really funny. Sometimes it's frustrating, but it's mostly funny.
Well, it felt like school. Like you have to go in this And if you're going to, at least for me, how school was for me, I wasn't going to get anywhere by not talking to anybody. I needed to ask people, like, how do I do this? How do I fix this problem? Or to get some social energy from people in order to not be so bored with whatever I was doing in school that I was going to just quit and go start a funk band or something. So, so for me, it was perfect for the, I did start a funk band.
You should have done, really?
Yeah, yeah, that's a whole other story. So yes, it was.
No. Wait. I got to hear. No, we don't tell me right now. But I am fascinated you started a funk band because that, yeah, that sounds like a lot of fun.
It was all right.
If there's anything that you're going to play as a band, funk is probably one of the more fun things because it's like, there's probably not a lot of angst. It's a lot of fun. It's like, let's all have a good time. It's like, funk.
The standards were generally low. And there was like 20 people in the band, some of them did nothing. So it was very Parliament Funkadelic influence.
Anywho, that's so awesome.
Oh, that's nice of you to say. Yeah, so Mighty Switch Force Academy is, and stop me if I'm forgetting this, because I do forget things. Is there a level editor already?
There's not. You know, a lot of people have been asking for it, and it it makes sense that there could be one, because, you know, it's on Steam. You have things like Steam Workshop. And other games have done it, especially games made in Game Maker. I have been making levels for Switch Force for about 4 years now. And the idea scares me because there's so many nuances of things that you can't do or things that would break. So like things we were doing on the first Switch Force that we just kind of stopped doing as like a general rule, like don't never do this when making a level, like never put one of the hooligan sisters somewhere where she could drop and land on a switch block. Bats don't intersect switch blocks. Other things I forget, you know, don't intersect switch blocks. A launch block, you can't put a launch block next to a wall or launch someone into a wall. Because then things just break. And we even do small fudging shortcuts here and there where when you are launching a bomb or yourself in this direction, and then there's like an arrow going tangent to that, like up or down, that there's not a wall there. And if there is a wall, there's just like a little bit of collision missing, because then you get a little more forgiveness in what you're launching. Unless you're launching yourself and it doesn't matter as much. I think it has more to do with the bombs and explosions. But there's so many little nuances of that I just feel it'll get kind of broken. And I know people are all about the level editor right now, especially like Mario Maker. But like when I see some of the things made in Mario Maker, I'm just like, there's a lot of nuance to getting all that to work right, mm-hmm. and a lot of new broken rules that they're making work that I just don't think there's as much complexity in Switch Force to make it happen. So I don't know. We'll see. I won't say no yet, but we'll see. I also say that, like, you know, right now I'm the only one working on it, and I want to focus on making more content, making more levels, and making more, you know, getting versus mode working for multiplayer. That's the thing I'm really excited about. So, I've got about, you know, right now there's 5 classic stages in the current build of the game. I think there's 11. Stages total, and outside of those, and I have 2 more that I'm testing right now that are going through testers, and I'm gonna be arting those up soon, and we're gonna do 2 more, so it'll be about 15 and then the 5 classic stages, and then I'm going to shift focus onto versus mode and get that working and get a few stages of versus mode, make sure versus mode is working, make sure that there's good multiplayer options there, and then get a build out of that hopefully sometime in October. And then go back to making levels again. So hoping to have, you know, 20 to 30 levels of normal levels in the final game. But any time taken away from those towards something like a level editor, it's more content potentially, but, you know, it might not be good tailored content. You know, I would argue that some of the Mario Maker levels aren't worth the price of entry, because some of them, because you're getting them randomly, can be pretty garbage, and you'd miss some of the really great ones, and you have to go hunt down the great ones, and, you know, I don't know if that's kind of the experience, you know, we don't have the bandwidth to make, you know, that kind of experience for our players just now, so.
Sure, yeah, not easy to just do all things whenever you want, which is one of the themes of our conversation. That's, you can't just say whatever you want, you can't just do whatever you want.
You can't do it, you know, you adulthood, you can't do, you know, it's like, when I was a teenager, I just did what I wanted when I wanted to. I'm gonna sit up and play Metal Gear Solid. you know, I don't work my job until 3 p.m. the next day. I'm going to sit up and play it until 8 a.m. and then, you know, maybe sleep and then go roll into my job and deliver some pizza and then go home and do it again. And because I want to, that's my thing. And, you know, if I don't want to show up for my job, I won't, because I'm living at home and, you know, whatever. But now it's like, you know, there's a limited number of hours in the day. It's like, how are you going to spend your time? This morning I put together a table. I made a table, you know, out of like planks of wood for my kid. And it's like, you know, I could have been doing many other things, but it's like I needed to get it done in a certain time frame. And it's like, that's what I did and that's what I'm going to do. You know, it's just you there's not enough hours in the day. So many other cliches. It's like when you get the older you get, the more angry you get that cliches were always right. It's so lame, but it's like, damn it, those cliches just, they work. You hate them when you're young. How's the family? How's the kids? How's life? It's like, oh, adults are stupid. And you don't see your friends for like 5 years. Like, oh my God, how are your kids? How's the life? How's the job? You know, it's like you grow up to be the thing you hated as a teenager. So.
Yeah. I think we might have hated it when we were teenagers because we knew someday that was going to take over our lives.
And I vowed to never be that.
And here we are.
And I'm genuinely interested in like, and that kind of stuff. Oh my gosh, can you believe the weather? No, I still hate that. But
I'm having fun in my mind being a collaborator with you on Switch Force Academy, which is not something you asked me to do. Oh well, I'll be quick about it. What do I
do it?
Jeez, we got an hour. I wonder, one of the things about Mario Maker that I think would have made it better is if there was a little bit more in the way of limitations on what you could do, like how many blocks you could lay here and there. So many people are just like, oh, if I can put all turtles on screen, then I will. That's a level, just all the turtles is the name of the level. And you talked before about Switch Force having certain things you shouldn't do. If people had, like, they could only put down, like, you know, arbitrary number, 20 Switch blocks for every five screens or four screens or something. If you put all these limits on them, it might cause them to make less crappy levels. Because I know that the sense I got was that you were worried that, you know, you've been making Switch Force levels for 4 years. It's not easy. It's harder, I would imagine, than making a Mario level, where Mario is a jumping game, whereas Switch Force is a jumping and shooting and moving blocks in and out of the foreground game. It's a lot more to it in terms of just the core mechanics of it. Mario can be expanded in all these ways, but Switch Force at the start, it's not a Switch Force level unless you're doing those three things. I don't know. Limits on people? Could that keep them from being awful?
I actually don't think so. I think it could be worse. I mean, hey, we're having a discussion.
Oh, yeah, sure.
But I actually think that, you know, some of those levels can be really, really stupid in Mario Maker. And the people that make them are even stupider. No,
I'm one of them.
But yeah, okay. Well, we already know you're so, so dumb. that's actually really good. You need to push the boundaries of your creativity. Hmm. I mean, that's what creation is, where it's just like, okay, I've got this thing. Well, what happens if I did the exact opposite?
Mm.
Pixar does this, where, you know, they go through, like, you know, how do you develop a story? And it's like, look at your character. What's their decision? Why are they making this decision? What if they did the opposite of that? Mm. And so you need to find the limits. You need to find the boundaries. Put as many things as you can in the level. What if I made the wall nothing but switch blocks? What would happen? What if I just made this thing that was impossible to get through? What if I made this huge jump? And sometimes you'd be surprised and you find something that's so close to what ends up being in the final game. So I think that's actually a good thing. I think what the problem is with limits is that it's actually harder to determine those limits ahead of time and program some of those in. Mm. And then you also need to, especially with an editor, you need to communicate to the player that there are limits, that, you know, okay, you know, I have this editor. How do I select the item from the editor? How do I tell the player that they have like 7 of 20 in there? How do I change the graphic to say X, put an X over it to say like, no, you can't use it anymore. It's a UX nightmare for creating a level editor like that. And it's kind of funny that Mario Maker did. It's like a game in all on its own of just like setting all those things up in a very manageable way, it's a task. That's a heavy duty task. So, I would not relish it at all.
Yeah.
Also with Mario, I mean, Mario works well too, because he's such a mobile character. He has such mobility. He has so much agency in just, you know, being able to jump and move and do so many other nuanced things with Academy or with Switch Force. You know, Patty has, since it's a puzzle game first, she has a finite jump. Her jump is the same every time. It's a fixed jump. She has a fixed jump height and a fixed speed. She doesn't have acceleration. She doesn't have, two run speeds. She doesn't have an accelerated run speed. It's a fixed run speed and a fixed jump height to work with puzzles. I think a lot of levels ended up being very samey. They would kind of become the same. And it's very hard not to do samey levels in Switch Force, especially when you've done multiple Switch Force games. And it's like, I'm having a struggle in creating levels that are not copies of old puzzles, but also, I ran into this problem with Switch Force 2 also, where it's like, I need to make levels that will work for someone who's never played it before, but isn't the exact same puzzle that taught someone playing Switch Force 1 what it was. Mm-hmm. So it's like, I have to create two things. So something that works for both players that have played previous ones that is a little bit different, but still teaches people who've never played it before. That's really hard. I underestimated how hard that would be when we first did Switch Force 2, and I designed the first level in that game. And then with Academy, it's sort of a similar thing. And then someone was playing it the other day, and something happened with the bomb where you just walk a bomb and shoot it. And I was like, oh my gosh, wait, did I not do that sooner? So it's just like some things I was doing in later levels I thought we'd taught earlier, but we didn't. So it's kind of like you start blending things, and it's hard not to just repeat patterns sometimes. So
yeah, because you've got, your brain is different, but you're still Austin Ivansmith, the person who did that, who taught that lesson before. So I can only imagine what it would be like for someone to say to me, like, help someone learn something, this specific thing, but teach them in a completely different way so it feels fresh. And they've maybe already learned it, but maybe they haven't. Make it equally good for everybody.
That's what makes it a challenge. That's what makes makes it kind of fun. Game development can be a puzzle in itself sometimes. So it's kind of like, if you like puzzle games, sometimes making a game is very similar. So it can be fun.
And do you think that doing the versus mode in Academy will help you to kind of get a fresh taste of how Switch Force thinking happens? And then maybe we'll make the remainder levels you're going to work on, something that pops out maybe more spontaneously. I don't know.
Yeah, I'm not sure. I hadn't really thought about that. That might be interesting. And that's sort of what's fun about development in general, and that's why I think Academy going early access, it's a window into the development process, where it's just like, okay, well, we design these levels. One of the things we did with the first Switch Force was, well, let's look at existing levels and build similar components, or in a couple instances we did had like remixes of previous levels or like revisits. And so maybe with versus mode, when we start seeing people play a certain way, it's like, oh yeah, let's make a puzzle that works kind of like this. In fact, the three levels that were the bonus content in the first Mighty Switch Force were direct responses to what people were saying when they played Mighty Switch Force the first one, where it's like, oh man, I like this level, or I like this level, or I hate the auto switching level. It's like, well, let's make another auto switching level because people hate it. So that makes the perfect final level. Talking about boundaries, Chris Schroeder, one of our level designers, he said, I want to make a level with nothing but lock blocks, the red and blue blocks. And I said, try it, see what happens. He said, I just want spikes all along the bottom and lock blocks, and that's it. And I didn't think we could do it. And we needed some soft platforms for checkpoints and for the girls to stand on. But other than that, it was all blocks, and it worked really well. It was one of the bonus stages, like bonus, I think, 3. And it was a hard level. So, that kind of stuff is really great. And that was, that was very emergent. That was very much after the fact. It was after we had made stuff. And I have a few ideas for what to do in the next Switch Force level. Some people talked about symmetry, and we're going to go back, because the levels aren't locked down yet. A couple of the early levels, they're very symmetrical, and I want to, change their symmetry a little bit. I want to make them slightly symmetrical, but change a little bit of the block puzzles inside. but I have one that's like a complete stair step. So it's like not symmetrical at all. And I have another one that's just, you know, some chambers that you can't see into until you enter it, and a wall disappears. So it's like, what's this? So, you know, what the next levels are, I'm not sure. In fact, if anyone has a game that's early access, and they go on the Steam forums, if they did a doodle, if they did a drawing, like, I think a level should look like this, you know, it'd be like, oh, that's cool, I'll try it. Or I've got, that gives me an idea for, you know, I want to see a level has this kind of puzzle in it. Let's do it. You know, like we're the fans who, you know, have the game are really engaged right now. They're giving us feedback and telling us what's broken and what they'd like to see. And, you know, like the girl counter, which is like the little marker for how many girls you've collected, wasn't in the game at first. I didn't think it was as necessary, but as it turns out, it was, and fans said it was, so I put it in, and I'm glad I did. And, you know, without them giving us that feedback, it might not have happened. So if people have feedback for actual levels or ideas, I'm all ears. I'll try it.
That has caused me, and you're welcome in advance, I have solved your... Sorry about that. It just came out. I've been thinking.
Thank
a lot
you,
about,
thank you, Jonathan Holmes.
You don't even know already, and you're already how kind of you. Did you play any WarioWare Do It Yourself?
I didn't play DIY. No, Matt Bozon designed a level that I think got featured.
Yeah, it did.
It had like a little monkey dash thing that got featured. I did not get DIY. I didn't have a DSi at the time, so I didn't check it out. No.
It's unfortunately Nintendo's online services are down, so you can no longer access those levels. If you have them saved on SD cards, you can still play them. And there's someone out on the internet somewhere who's like kept them all. So it's worth checking out. My long-winded point is DIY is actually better than Mario Maker in one way. If you don't really want to make a level, you can just draw a comic book instead.
Like that's cool.
So what if and this may be way too big of a pain in the neck, but I have it like fixed in my head that people want user created content from Academy, because it's like that school feeling, you're doodling in your notebook and you're sharing it with a friend. It just feels like that's a marketing bullet point for whatever that's worth for your video game. So what if people could just draw a level and be like, this would be a neat level, and like send it to you in the game, or send it to each other, or just draw a little paddy wagon comic strip, four panels or so. People love drawing way forward characters. You have a huge fan art community. It may be a completely foreign thing to Game Maker, it may be impossible, but I feel like allowing people to give a little bit of themselves to the rest of the players, and specifically to you, like if people knew they could draw a little thing and you would see it, they'd freak out. They'd be so happy.
No, I mean, we're very active on like Twitter and Facebook, and we have like fan art Fridays. So we do get a lot of fan art, which is really cool. I think that, you know, taking some designs and just having them sort of fold in would be really hard. but I would love to see ideas. Like I am all ears. I mean, you know, all ears, all eyes, you know, just, yeah, let's see it, like share it. I want to see that. I love that kind of stuff. We get emails and fan letters, you know, like, you know, in the mail, like snail mail sometimes. And it's just really neat. Like, oh man, like someone likes our work that much to reach out like this. It's awesome. I don't know how automated it would be to fold it in. I think really big studios with big budgets have really made it seem easier than it is, making it harder for some of the little guys. But I know there's lots of like smaller studios that have done it too, so maybe I'm just lazy.
Never crossed my mind that laziness was the issue, but there
there is what would I rather do today? Do I want to do that? No, I don't want to do that. That's lazy. That's me being lazy.
A person's personality is in many ways defined by what is a thing that is like a ton of work for somebody else, but for them, it's like, this is great. This is a hobby. This is what I do. You know, making video games for some people would be like the most painful, difficult, like stressful, arduous task. But for you, it's a Saturday night.
But that's what painting is for me. And I've done some paintings, and I've done some like pixel paintings. I've done some like watercolor paintings. I've done some good paintings. But while I'm painting, I hate painting. I'm frustrated at the medium. I'm frustrated at the paint. I'm frustrated at the mixing. I feel like I'm not getting the results I want while I'm doing it. And it's, you know, part of it, lack of patience, lack of experience, lack of trust, and just a frustration with the medium. And, you know, it can be hard when you're making art and it doesn't look like the final product while you're making it. So it's the steps in the process aren't meeting your expectation of how it should look in its complete form. But I understand, you know, some of the steps in the process, and when it isn't looking like my expectations in the steps in the process, I get frustrated as well. So I kind of hate painting, and I don't get as much enjoyment out of drawing as I did when I was a teenager and I was in school and I was supposed to be taking notes in class and I was just drawing all day in class. Funny enough, when I look back at my old pencil drawings, I remember what the teacher was talking about while I was making those drawings. So they kind of became like notes. So all you kids that draw in school, keep drawing in school. But some people maybe popping open a program and typing up some things won't work, but I feel like the satisfaction I get out of making things in Game Maker. I mean, I got a similar satisfaction today when, you know, we bought 3 planks of wood and I cut them into pieces and I drilled holes and I put it together and I constructed a table for, you know, to put a bucket in, put sand in. So it's like a sand table, you know, for the kids to play on. I get that same satisfaction in Game Maker. I get that same satisfaction when I create an object, give it some properties, assign it a sprite and, you know, give it controller interaction and then hit play. And now I'm manipulating it in game, or it has some sort of AI values where it's doing something I told it to do. It's so rewarding. It's so immediately rewarding and it's so fascinating and it's so enjoyable. It's such a great hobby. And the hardest thing is finishing something. And the hardest thing is putting it out on a store. And I've had people come to me and be like, hey man, that's so cool that like you put out that garbage truck game for your kid. I couldn't go home at night and start working on something. And it's like, to me, while I'm making it, I'm not working on it. When I'm, you know, putting together art for the store, or, you know, words, or putting together words, when I'm doing the writing, the writing for the descriptions, and when I'm having to do submission processes and all the paperwork and stuff, yeah, that's work and it's frustrating. But while I'm making the stuff in the earlier steps, it's just fun. It's just enjoyable. So that's why I keep doing it. I just get a lot of satisfaction out of making things.
That's awesome. I don't know if we garbage truck game. Did we talk about, you alluded to it earlier.
Yeah.
So that's, I don't even know what that is. What is this thing?
Okay. So that's kind of what started me doing stuff, just on the side and, all together was my son was a year to a year and a half old. We had an iPad and, you know, I thought it might be neat. Like, he liked trucks, you know, and he's a boy. And, you know, did you have a son or a daughter?
Well, we have a son.
You have a son. Okay. He's going to like trucks a lot. Our daughter likes trucks, but it's like, we have a boy and a girl, and no matter what you know, expose them to, somehow our son loved trucks and our daughter loves the color pink. And like, we were like, we are never getting her things the color pink. And then she just loves pink. It's like, how the heck do you like pink? She likes trucks too. See, she likes trucks. And my son likes babies. So he has a baby doll. But he loves trucks and she loves babies. So he loved trucks so much. And all kids love garbage trucks. I was like, oh, let's get him a garbage truck, iPad, you know, iPhone game. And they were all horrible for someone as young as him. He wasn't even 2. And granted, we don't just like, you know, sit him down in front of the TV or sit him down in front of an iPad and just say like, yeah, go for it. We're going to go, you know, smoke crack and play WoW and ignore you. It was just this might be fun to just try every now and then. And it just wasn't good for him. So I'm like, I'll just make something. And I tried doing it in different programs and I came back to Game Maker. And my wife was encouraging me to make stuff in my own time. And I thought I'd do something simple, something easy, something that, you know, didn't have platforming code, didn't have crazy like room, you know, scrolling art. A lot of the things that are difficult to do. So I eased myself in by starting with garbage truck. So I did an illustration and it's just a simple illustration of a garbage truck. And then I just colored it like one of his favorite books. And then I just got that working. So it's a game where there's no fail state. So that was a big thing with a lot of the garbage truck games, is it was all verbal commands. For kids under three, verbal commands are very hard, especially when it's not coming from family members. And then fail states where it's telling them to like, oh yeah, pick up this item, put it in this can. And they don't know what they're talking about. Then the game like fail, you know, game overs or whatever. So I just have a game where there's no fail states. Any place on the screen you touch, you'll get a response or an interaction. And that's basically it. So I made it for him and it was really funny. Like he still checks it out from time to time. Just a few months ago, I was sitting at my desk working, you know, on something like an email on like a Saturday, and he just pulls up his chair next to me and he just sits down and I'm just, you know, thinking he's going to play with his toys or whatever. And then I hear the garbage truck game and I look down and he's playing garbage truck. He's like, burr, burr, like playing it. I'm like, oh my God, that's so cool. So, you know, it's kind of like, it's a really good example of, if you know, for someone who wants to learn how to program or wants to learn how to make games on their own, start with something simple. Do something so simple. Don't make a whole game. Make something very, very easy to make and very simple. And that's what I did. And it's done pretty well. You know, it's made money. You know, it makes like a few dollars a day. Cool. It's nothing amazing. Yeah. But it basically pays for an Apple developer program every year. And I got a letter from a woman whose son is autistic. He's on the autism spectrum, and he loves garbage trucks. And, you know, he was featured on the news where, you know, like he's friends with his a neighborhood garbage man who brought him a garbage truck toy. But she wrote me and just said, like, some of these games are hard for him and he just gets frustrated and angry and he loves your game. So thank you for that. I'm like, oh man, that's so awesome. So I've been meaning to do a few more trucks for my kid, but I was doing other games and then I did Academy. And again, it's like, which thing should I move forward with? And then, yeah, you just never know. So
yeah, so many options. Yeah. But so much responsibility at the same time. Good grief. Could there be a garbage truck cameo in Academy? Can you just...
That'd be nice. No, like there's definitely a distinction between what I do in my spare time and Way Forward. So, you know, basically anything I do in my spare time, I bring to Matt and Boldy first and I say like, hey, I want to make this. Do we want to do it with Way Forward? And kind of give them like first right of refusal. So, you know, because I'm a Way Forward employee first in my mind. So they'll say like, no, we don't want to do that. Or, oh, that's a neat idea. Yeah, let's hold on to it. So then I won't work on that one in my spare time. But if they say, no, we have no interest. We have no interest in doing a kid's game. That's a kid's garbage truck game. Okay, cool. I'm going to go do it then. So from that point on, the game's mine. I can do whatever I want. But because it's also mine, doing a garbage truck cameo might be a little weird.
Yeah, I suppose it would. But to me, I have, in my mind anyway, ingrained you in Switch Force so deeply. Like you are the guy who has taken Switch Force and ran with it in my brain. So
yeah, and thank you. No, I kind of am that guy. Like I kind of Switch Force means a lot to me. It's really funny because I was actually working on Switch Force when I found out my wife was pregnant with my son. I was working on HD at home while we were doing DuckTales. So it was sort of I guess in a way I was doing Switch Force in my spare time, even when, you know, 3 years ago when we were doing DuckTales. I started doing two and then I had to abandon two to focus on HD and focus on DuckTales. But you know, there's still some of my hand in that and a few of the level designs. I just care passionately about Switch Force, the brand and the series. I've been very fortunate to, you know, have Matt recognize that and say like, yeah, you really, you know, Switch Force, you kind of are the spirit of it with like level designs. And that's why we wanted to return to, you know, something traditional. Hose It Down was a fun experiment. It was a really good side project. But we didn't want to do another complete side project. And I know people were like expecting Switch Force 3. And this is kind of the third true like Switch Force title, but it's not technically 3. But it's closer to a true sequel than Hose It Down was. So.
Sure. Yeah, I would imagine 3, it's become like the Metal Gear series in some ways. Switch Force has. When that number comes out.
Are you... Don't mind me. Don't look at me. Don't look at me.
Oh, I'm sorry. My mistake.
Thanks, Jonathan. I'm trying to use a Kleenex here. Goodness.
When the number 3 appears on the next Switch Force game or on a future Switch Force game, it's going to, I'd imagine, be as Switch Force 2 was, where it is Switch Force, but it is somehow a full variation on what she's up to.
She will be an amiibo herself, and she will be running around as an amiibo.
Because there's third-party characters in Mario Maker, I would love Paddy Wagon or Shantae to be in there. And you, Nintendo, it could, anything's possible. Questions, come on, Nintendo. Come on, Nintendo. You know Damon Baker, I'm sure. He's a neat guy. You can ask him about it. I will ask the questions aloud. But before I forget, people should also know you made a game about the president. Didn't you?
I did.
We shouldn't forget that one.
I made a game called Super Secret Service. I made that game with Johan Vanette, who is an amazing artist. I think he did a lot of the backgrounds and some of the animations for Rivals of Aether, which is out right now. I think it's Rivals of Aether. I might be pronouncing it wrong, but that's kind of like a Smash-inspired game.
Did he work on Extreme Exorcism?
Yep, I was just going to say that, Extreme Exorcism. So yeah, Johan Vanette is just an amazing artist, and I loved his art online. I messaged him and just said, hey, because I was going to do Secret Service on my own. I looked at my pixel art and I'm like, this is awful. I should collaborate with someone. And so I reached out to, I did Flippy Bard. I actually started Secret Service like a month after I did Flippy Bard. And I'm like, I shouldn't do my own art again. Because I did all the art in Flippy Bard, except for the Genzo Man illustration. But anyway, Johan did an amazing job, and Flashy Goodness did the music for it. And that guy just understands like SNES style sound, and they were just a phenomenal little team. We put the game out around Election Day last year. Unfortunately, that didn't get us like a ton of attention, but it did pretty well. You know, it sold a few thousand units, and it paid off some dentist bills at the time, so that was like kind of perfect. It didn't, you know, take off. Got good reviews. Some places reviewed it. You know, I have, you know, experience like reaching out to publishers and you know journalists and stuff, so I just wrote a little WordPress and for a press kit, and just like, hey, check this out, and some people did, and they liked it. But it wasn't a free game, and it was just like an infinite thing, and no one wants to pay money for just like an infinite thing right now. They want a free thing if it's going to be infinite, or they want to pay money for something that has content that unlocks along the way. It's just the nature of that platform. So I'm proud of it. I'm very happy with it. And now it's free, and there's like in-app purchases for just, you know, unlocking more secret items or something. So that's just how it's going to exist from now on. I'm just kind of done with it. You know, it's in the state it's going to be forever. And I'm happy with how it turned out. It was a fun little game to work on. So
yeah, I think, and hearing that it's free, people have no excuse not to check it out.
Yeah, seriously.
Just a fun looking game and a fun to play game. So
yeah. Johan is amazing. I think he's at Tribute Games now. He's working on stuff for Tribute. He's in Canada. He was in France at the time, and now he's in Canada. And I want to message him again because I want to work with that guy again, because his work was just so amazing. And he just killed it. It was just like the perfect little just side project, just fun to work on. So
That's fun. All right, questions from the viewers. We've got D'Oberto. Asks, do you guys only hire locally? I think he wants to work for Way Forward, and who doesn't?
We hire from all over. You know, there's a link on our website, wayforward.com. I think the email address, if it's not listed there, there's iwantajob@wayforward.com, and just apply. You know, we hire people from all over the world. Sometimes if you're an artist, we'll do freelance stuff, so people can just, do a number of pieces and we'll pay them per piece, or we have offsite programmers. So it's, and sometimes people just move here and they work on site. So
anything's possible with Way Forward.
Possible. Yeah. There you go.
Yeah, so many amazing artists. I mean, if I remember correctly, Paul Robertson, animator, pretty famous in like, I love internet cartoons circles.
He did a lot. He did a lot of Way Forward stuff back in like 10 years ago. Before he became the Paul Robertson he is today, where he's like, like this nearly household name, but you know, just amazing guy. It's just hard to believe if you tell people like, oh yeah, he did a lot of Way Forward. I was like, really? Like, you know, like.
He did the Worm King and Hey Ice King, Where's Our Garbage?
Yep. I think. Oh yeah. Just like his work is amazing. So, I'm not sure if he did stuff on Thor, but like Mariel did some pixel art on Thor.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yep. Tron Knots. Not your Tron Knots. Wait, no. TJ, I think Natasha, I forget the name.
Tron Maximum.
Tron Maximum, thank you. Of Joylancer fame. She did pixel art on Thor.
Really? I had no idea.
Yep, animations. Forget the name of the artist. Did Catacomb Kids, did some animations on Thor. There's a lot of people that did animations on Thor. And so it was pretty cool. But we have a lot of cool people that just, you know, do some freelance stuff, do some offsite stuff, and.
Yeah, what a place.
There's been a lot of names. It's hard to remember them all. Sorry to anyone I didn't mention.
Ah, well. Tito, it's cool. So dark where I am now. I'm like a flashlight-faced man. I don't know what happened. Tito Hakonen? I hope so, Tito. Sorry if I got it wrong. Asks, is getting the rest/sum of the getting some of the rest/sum unattained stretch goal chapters. Yeah, I'm not drunk, but I sound it. In Half Genie Hero, a possibility. So those stretch goals you didn't make. We could have talked a lot more about Half Genie Hero.
Coming we probably should have talked a lot more about Half Genie Hero.
I'm gonna get
like shoved in a corner. You don't understand, Holmes. I'm gonna get the closet. It's a spiked room where Voldy puts you when he's mad at you. I'm going to get it tomorrow.
It's not too late. I have Genie Hero, a prequel, beautiful art style, HD graphics. It's going to be on all the consoles. It's a 2D platformer. Sometimes it's vertical, sometimes
it's... We did talk about it a little bit. No pressure.
Yeah, we did good.
I don't think we're going to be doing the... I don't think we're going to do the stretch goals that didn't make it. No. We're only doing the stretch goals that didn't make it. So.
Right. Though I'd imagine, because you as we've talked about, you don't want to say no or right. Yes. So
this is a time where we're content to say no.
So even if the game, let's say it sells 10 million copies.
When the game comes out and then it sells millions of copies, we will then evaluate that, but then it'll also take time. Mm. But so that would be the one time I would say no. But as it stands, there's already like a lot of scope, and there is not a plan to do more than what exists there. There's also the idea that we could put it towards, you know, a future game or a sequel or something else. You know, if it did extremely well, we wouldn't have to kickstart a sequel. We could just, you know, make the sequel outright or do another big game or a few small games from the outset. So.
Sure. Do you think that Half Genie Hero may kick off another trilogy as the first Shantae game on Game Boy Color eventually led to the DSiWare game, which led to the 3DS eShop game, which is now on Wii U and all sorts of places? Do you have that sense that this may be the start of another arc like that?
I'm actually not sure. I think Matt doesn't want to get tied into a trilogy at all, because when you do the first one, if you kind of get sick of it by the second one, you're like, crap, I got to do a third one too. Sure. So there was a lot of pressure for like Pirate's Curse to like wrap up a trilogy, especially when you look at Pirate's Curse and it's very different from Risky's Revenge in a lot of ways with like some of the game mechanics. So it's... I don't think we're gonna. I don't think we want to lock ourselves to a number beforehand. But that's a question better answered by Matt, because you know he's like the keeper of Shantae lore and the decision maker on that. But I don't think so. I think we're better off keeping it open and then just being able to do however many sequels we want, and then not and having them, you know, be their own thing if they want to be.
Sure. Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. Sandy Gordon is a great artist in his own right. Good old Sandy asks, Austin, what's your development process like in the crafting of such an epic and iconic man beard?
It a lot of work, Sandy. Sandy and I have talked a lot on Twitter, and you should check out him and Zach Bell are doing stuff for Space Boy Games. And so he's trolling me a little bit.
Can we get on Far Away?
They're doing Far Away right now. Yeah, them and I think Felipe. Yeah, they're doing some pretty neat stuff there. So he's trolling me. Thank you, Sandy. I appreciate it. I don't like my beard as much. You know, I don't like shaving. It becomes a pain in the butt. And my wife just doesn't like my scratchy face. So I just grow it out a little bit. And I just need to keep it clean. And it doesn't grow as like thick as I want. I'd like to create a, I want to be a Santa Claus someday. I want to have a big white Santa Claus beard. I love kids and I love interacting with kids. And that's the other thing too, now that you have kids, Jonathan, you're going to find that you can talk to kids a lot easier. You know, it's like, you know, if you ever try to talk to a 5-year-old and you say like weird things, they don't like you. When you have kids and you have your own 3-year-old, like you get really good at it. And now I love kids more than ever and I want to be Santa Claus, but my beard just doesn't grow long. So I'm kind of sad about that. I'll need a fake beard. So thanks for reminding me of that, Sandy. Very nice of you.
Sandy Claus, maybe. I wonder what his beard is like. Yeah, like good that. One.
That's a good just one.
Yeah.
That's a good one.
How did it go by? So there's so much I still want to talk about.
Roiland. Thanks, Adam. I love the trolls. I love the trolling. It's just, yeah. I was Phil Fish before Phil Fish was Phil Fish. And Justin Roiland can go eat something like a sandwich. We eat a sandwich. We eat a big sandwich. Justin's actually come to the studio, so he's a nice guy.
He is.
I like him. Hi, Justin.
He made Rick and Morty.
Yep, he raided Rick and Morty with Dan Harmon, and he was the voice of Lemon Grab. And so when we were working on one of the Adventure Time games, he just came to the studio and hung out. We were talking for like an hour, and then he was telling us about Rick and Morty. He's like, "Yeah, I got this pilot. You want to check it out?" So I got to see the pilot like months beforehand. I'm like, "Wow, this is really funny," and I'm really happy for him that it's done as well as it has. So, I like Justin. So
he's nice. He's following me on Twitter, which was a shock. He's like a big deal in my brain.
And he's become a bigger deal too. So it's pretty neat. No, he's a huge gamer. It's funny because like he has multiple 3DSs and like when I went to E3 last year and like I checked my Street Pass tags and he was the first one and I'm like, "Oh dude, we Street Passed. Where were you?" He's like, "Oh, that wasn't me. Someone had to take my 3DS. I needed Street Passes. I had to be in the studio, so they took my 3DS to E3 for me."
That's actually how he I didn't start talking to him on Twitter about like all the fanboy stuff. Like, "Oh my god, how do you do those voices and how do you like manage to sound natural while also following a script, all this stuff that like impresses me." I was just like, "How many 3DSs do you actually have?" I've got the Link Between Worlds one. I'm like, you want the Majora's Mask one? We can trade. Like this guy, he's on TV. I assume he's got enough people offering him Majora's Mask 3DSs. But he was like, "Oh wow, seriously, dude? That could be a cool trade." I'm like, "Did you notice you're a movie star? What's going on?"
No, he's a really cool guy, and he's a big gamer. Like, he was really bummed because he lost his 3DS, and he came to our studio, and we gave him some download codes because he lost his 3DS, and he couldn't get his old download codes back or whatever when he had to buy a new one. So we just gave him some download codes for the games he already owns. Yeah. He's a nice guy, big-time gamer. So.
Yeah, I wonder if he'll make a Rick and Morty game with Way Forward. That would be fun.
That would be really cool, you know, but I can't talk about that kind of thing. Thank you, Jonathan, though. Thank you.
It's just an idea.
Remember at the beginning when I said, like, "Oh, yeah, ask me anything, and I'll answer it very professionally," and it's just me deflecting back at you, like, "Thanks, dude, thanks." No.
That's what professionals do.
No, I would love to make a Rick and Morty game with Justin, so I'm going to message him on Twitter tonight and be like, "Dude, me and this guy, I forget his name, Jonathan Holmes? Yeah, that's it. He wants us to make a game. Let's do it."
That'll go well. Done. and we're out of time. We're over time. There's so many other things I wanted to ask. I wonder, Sinistar hasn't given us the shut up bell. He
probably will soon. Yeah, because he's a heartless beast.
He is a monster. But there's so many questions I want to ask about Way Forward in general. I mean, maybe Matt will be on the show again and I could ask him instead. I've seen Way Forward have this like really bizarre, to me it's been bizarre, arc of like starting off as a Game Boy Color dev that like some people are really passionate about but most people don't know about. And then like groundswell of support for you. And then I've noticed like a weird Way Forward backlash. Have you noticed this in the past couple of years? That because so many people loved you so much, that people are like, "Way Forward's not that good." They made
that's
like
normal.
One game
that's,
I didn't
that's,
like that much.
I mean, that's so normal with anything where it's like anything that becomes popular, you know, once other people that don't like something or be paying attention, they're like, "No, that's awful," you know. So that kind of thing happens with anything that becomes popular. And so we've been fortunate enough to have more people notice who we are, so that there's more people that say they don't like us. So
It does, but I don't know. For whatever reason, in the case of Way Forward, it seems like strangely intense on either end.
I think sometimes like we've released some games that are like people are passionate about some licenses, you know, and it's like you look at, take DuckTales, for example. There's some people that think that we ruined DuckTales. And there's some people that we talk to are just like, oh no, you guys did an amazing job with DuckTales. You know, it's very divisive. There's like a huge dichotomy between like love and hate, especially in fandom and in the industry. And, you know, that happens. And sometimes you have games and you have products that, you know, don't live up to players' expectations, and, you know, they don't realize some of the decisions that had to be made or the decisions that were out of our hands. You know, when you have a licensor or you have a publisher and you tell them the game has to be this way, and they're like, no, we don't have time, or no, we refuse to do that. And then when the game comes out, and then people get mad at us for something mm-hmm. that we didn't have any bearing on. Mm-hmm. But sometimes we make decisions that are, oh, we decided to do this. I decided to make sure that Scrooge had 8 coins to collect in the game, and that he talked at every single collection inside Amazon. And Tim Rogers stops me on the street at E3 and says, "Why'd you do that?" And he like starts yelling at me. And it's like, "I'm sorry, Tim. I'm sorry. You know, I did it because I didn't think it was bad until I saw it at E3. I'm like, oh my god, this is bad, but I can't go back and fix it. So yeah, it was a bad decision, and that stuff happens. But people, it's easy to remain mad at a company for that, because you know it's more faceless. You don't know the person. But if you're friends with someone there and you're like, why'd you do that? And they're like, oh man, we tried doing this and it didn't work. We tried doing this and it didn't work. And you go, oh well, that makes sense. You can become more forgiving. So I think there's also a satisfaction in being mad at somebody or someone. Like I get mad at my insurance company, or I get mad at Hulu, or I get mad at, you know, some other people for like, how dare you do this? And it's just, you kind of get a satisfaction of like, you need a little bit of that. You need something to be angry at to be happy at all the other things, maybe. So I don't know. It comes with the territory. It's something like, you know, you have to get comfortable with the idea of people not liking you. Mm-hmm. You know, you can't be friends with everyone, and there's going to be people that aren't going to like what you do. And you just try to, do what you want to do as an artist, and it's what everyone should do. It's just make things that they're happy with, make things that appeal to you, make things that aren't at, you know, at the very minimum, aren't going to be offensive or insanely inappropriate or, you know, incredibly racist or sexist or misogynist. You know, just don't make these horrible things, but make things that you really enjoy that make you happy. And there'll be other people that will enjoy them too, but there'll also be people that don't like it. And it's hard to get used to that, but you know, it's a fact that every artist has to face, and you grow kind of a thick skin with it. So
sure. Don't make things that are out to like harm people and knock them down and attack them, but make what comes naturally to you to try to build things up, to build something up, maybe to build other people up. You never know. It's funny, Justin Roiland, I don't know if he wrote that episode, but a recent episode of Rick and Morty, Beth, the wife character, says to Jerry, the husband character, you can't make people like you. The best you can do is wait for them to get bored of hating you. And that's what I've been doing.
I live my life. Yeah, that's right. I wouldn't be surprised if you wrote that. That's good. Yeah.
Yeah, it is very good. And I hope that you never quit. I hope that that any sort of attacks people launch at you for making a video game, for goodness sake. People are getting mad about that. But anyway, I hope you never give up. I hope you keep making things. I don't think you could stop if you wanted to. Seems like it's hardwired into your brain, your DNA brain. It's not
gonna... I don't know. We'll see. It's all I know how to do at this point, you know? And, you know, I don't have the option of just quitting today and just going and like, oh, I'll just go into this account firm and just, you know, do this thing to make money. It's the only skills I have. Like, it's like, if I go to apply somewhere else, it's like, wait, how would being good at developing games or being good at managing a game development team work for this? I'm like, I don't know. You know, I managed this team. I could probably manage that team, right? You know, like plumbing supplies and the infrastructure of a city, you know, thing is the same, right? Hey, I'll be fine. You'll see. You can't just say you'll see. It's all I know at this point, other than like pizza. So unless I open my pizza place, you know,
combine them. Video games.
That's a horrible idea, Jonathan.
Isn't pizza and video games together? It's a terrible idea.
It's always better.
There's a movie theater.
Oh no, there's someone here. There's someone here.
They're being really loud.
Well, we're 10 minutes over time, Eddie.
Okay. So we should sorry.
Go. That's not your fault. I enjoyed every second of it. So they can.
Me too. I'm sorry that we have to go so soon. I've had fun talking.
Me too.
I'm gonna miss you.
Yeah, likewise. They can see your thing, your video game specifically that you made, Mighty Switch Sports Academy. It's on Steam right now, early access.
Hey, Sean, I'm talking to you guys. Can you please be quiet? Are you on? I'm on right now. I'm live. Matt, come here. Come say hi.
Oh, it's Matt Bozon?
Matt Bozon.
Oh, cool.
Here's Matt. Here's Matt.
Hey, Matt. Hey. Great to see you.
Wait, I'm not in there.
Don't tell them about the Amiibo. What?
I was asking Austin if Shantae Amiibo was going to happen.
He's got my headphone. He was asking if Shantae Amiibo was going to happen. And I said, stop asking me that question, you jerk.
You should ask Aaron. Go get her.
But yeah, anyway, but we're out of time. But I just want to say hi.
Yeah. Great to see you, Matt. Oh, that's very nice.
There he goes.
Yeah. Speaking of Matt Bozon, Half Genie Hero, it's coming out sometime soonish. People can take a look at the Kickstarter page for updates. And it's going to be in, like, on everything. What do you think? Winter? It's going to come out when the snow's coming down?
Holiday. You know, we don't know if we're going to hit, you know, this holiday. Although holiday's technically like January also. So.
Yeah.
But it's going to take as long as it needs to take just to get it done because, you know, it was kickstarted and we, you know, want to make it good for the fans. Yeah. It's really far along. Things are really, really, really coming together right now. So, you know, if things keep going at the pace they're at, potentially it could be out in like December or January. But I don't see it going too much longer than that.
Sure.
But it's just a matter of circumstance because there's a lot of unknowns when you start actually like pushing things to different consoles, and then one console you have a technical issue, and we want to hit, you know, our main consoles all at the same time, same street date. So it's gonna be tricky. It's gonna be fun. The programmers gonna be pulling their hair out. So yeah,
it's very exciting.
Be a great Christmas.
And you, they can follow WayForward at WayForward. Is that right?
Yep.
And you are at Austin Ivan-Smith.
Yep. Ivan-Smith. No,
Austin. Oh, it's just Ivan Dashmith.
Yeah, or just search my name, Austin Ivansmith. It'll come up. You'll have the pleasure of following me and all the stupid things I say.
And you've got the lasers behind your head.
I do. Yeah, well, that was the Academy thing. We were going with like an 80s, well, you know, Metal Gear VR and like, you know, kind of 80s vibe that we kind of kicked off with Double Dragon Neon that everyone copied. Blood Dragon. And then, we kind of got that going on. James White. There's a guy I follow on Twitter, Signal Noise. James White, big inspiration for like the look and feel of the game, and still got some more polish to do to make it feel as good. But that guy's art is amazing, and that's what I was going for. Oh, and then we were doing like the promotion. I thought like, oh, it'd be funny, like the '80s school picture. It was like school pictures, lasers. Oh my gosh! So yeah, we did that for the. It just seemed like kismet. So yeah, I've got that going on in my Twitter background. So
it's very good for more of that. Follow him on the Twitter. Me,
yes.
On Twitter, I'm at Tron Knots, and you can watch the show later on YouTube, youtube.com/SupHolmesShow. You can do that. Listen to it on iTunes or Libsyn. Just Google it. You'll get it that way. Promise. Just did it the other day. We're at like episode 163, I think. Good grief. 37 till we hit 200. So they're all on iTunes. And that's it for me.
And three of them have Austin Ivansmith in them. Thanks for having me, you guys.
Another pleasure. Likewise.